It's incredibly exciting. It's busy. There's fantastic variety. People dressed amazingly, and lots of good friends, old friends, and nice people. It's good. People want to know what the experience was like, which was it was quite extraordinary, really, in lots of ways. I remember sort of walking onto that set in Return of the Jedi on the first morning of filming with Caroline Blixton, and our breath was taken away because the set was so stunning, and it cost, I understand, something like £500,000 in like 1982. £500,000 is a lot of money today, even, but in 1982 it was enormous. But it's there for posterity in the movie, and it was quite sort of overwhelming to play on, really, because we weren't used to that kind of grandeur in filmmaking at that time. So that's the first question I tend to get asked, and fans are also very interested in the extra footage that was shot. There was a big sequence with George Lucas directing the second unit that I did 3 or 4 days on, which has surfaced, people tell me, on various forums and on the internet, and I think it's on some of the newer DVDs now. That was interesting to do at the time. But to be perfectly honest, I had no idea I would be here talking about that movie 30 odd years later, or whatever it is, 33 years, I think. It was a job for me at the time, an extremely enjoyable job. And who wouldn't want to get up in the morning and go and film and get to say, "May the Force be with you," and then go home and go to bed? I mean, it was a dream. But I thought that would be that. And when I do conventions like this, I'm constantly amazed at the long-term effect that the whole Star Wars universe has had on people, very often to the good. There are a lot worse things you can do than be a Star Wars fan.
So tell us the experience of working on such an iconic program like Father Ted.
It was absolutely glorious, I have to say. I don't know if you know how they did Father Ted, but what they used to do was that they would go to Ennis-Dyman in County Clare and film all of the exteriors for all 6 episodes in a series, and then the rest of the studio stuff would be done and rehearsed and done in London. So we did the Lovely Girls competition in Ennis-Dyman in County Clare. I still see them, as you probably know, they run them almost all the time on Channel 4. And the secret of Father Ted was the fact that the scripts were so magnificent. And they're on a par with Fawlty Towers scripts in that they totally stand up. And every time I see an episode, even if I've seen it, I don't know, 2 or 3 times before, I still laugh in mostly unexpected ways. But that's really due to the genius of the writing. They gave sort of depth to each character, all of those crazy mad priests in the catalogue. I mean, my character, who was called Father Liam Deliverance, his secret passion, which Graham Linehan told me, because he was going to come back if they did another series, is that his passion was that he was a Joan Collins, a Joan Crawford impersonator. So he would dress up as Joan Crawford in one of the mammy's dresses and do his Joan Crawford impersonation. And that was going to be a future episode, but sadly, due to the untimely and sad demise of Dermot Morgan, that was the end of it. A great, great tragedy and a huge loss. But his work lives on, you know.
I mean, how much fun was it getting to demolish half the set?
It was fantastic fun. I mean, it was very free in rehearsals because the part was written like that, but suddenly in rehearsing it, I found that maybe you could kind of like wrecked the chair he was sitting on as well as kind of throwing salt around. And there was a great sort of free and easy atmosphere there, that you could do anything as long as it, you know, it felt right. It was great, very happy indeed. And, you know, Dermot was wonderful to work with. They all were, and I'm still very good friends with Pauline McGlynn and see her, you know, I mean, she's a wonder. Yeah. In one sense, I try to do work that interests me, whether it's comedy or serious stuff. Luther has been one of my favourites. I've been doing it since like 2009, on and off. And in actual fact, we've just finished Luther 5. But then something like The Death of Stalin will come along, which is an absolute gift to any actor. So I like to mix it up. If the part and the writing appeals to me, I will do it. In terms of, it's interesting in terms of the actual work itself, the difference between doing something on stage is that the actor has a great deal of control, because it's just you and the audience, and actors love that. Whereas if you do film or television, you're, I suppose, at the mercy is the wrong word, but your performance is in the hands of the editor and the director and all that. And once you've actually done the filming, it's completely outside of your control. And very often good films and good TV are made in the cutting, in the editing room. So to that extent, I suppose there's more pure enjoyment out of doing stage work. But I love doing film and television, and the more varied, the better. Yeah. Film and television, you get up very early in the morning. I get about 4:30, and the work is long and hard. I mean, just looking across here, we film a lot of Luther around here in the East End, and it can be hard and sort of punishing, but it's over and it's relatively quick. And it pays more money. Theatre work is difficult. I'm doing a play at the moment, which is why I've got the beard. I'm not pretending to be General Madine from all those years ago. If you're doing a stage play, particularly if it's in something like the West End, and you're doing 8 shows a week, week in, week out, that's kind of exhausting. I mean, it's not coal mining. I can't pretend it's that kind of physically difficult. But you have to bear in mind, you have to have a sort of an integrity about it, because there are people coming to see that show for the first time and paying a lot of money. And it's the actor's duty to be as fresh and kind of, you know, as on the ball as they were on the first night, to give them the experience that they've paid for. And it's not easy to sustain that for a long period of time. That's what I find difficult, whereas the show I'm doing at the moment is in the National, and the great advantage of the National Theatre is that things are in repertoire. So we're opening this Translations by Brian Friel on Wednesday, and then we will have like 4 or 5 days off, and then we'll come back and we'll do another 6 or 7, and it's good like that. I like working like that.
Do you
enjoy it?
It's funny, but you mentioned the beard there, actually. Was the beard real in Return of the Jedi? Because I thought it looked like a little bit fake-ish.
Of course it was fake. Yes, it's the movies. It was very dodgy. If you look very close, you can see the spirit gum and everything. I mean, it wasn't great, to be perfectly honest. No, between that and the hair. Yeah, I'm glad you like The Death of Stalin. It's Yeah. Now, that was interesting because, I mean, in filming, you hardly ever get any time to rehearse. But Armando Iannucci, who had great control over that movie, bought or somehow manufactured 2 weeks for that company to rehearse together every day. So by the time it came to sort of turn over in the camera and start filming it, we all knew each other really well. So you kind of, and that spilled out when you saw it on film. It looked as if they knew each other for a long time because we kind of did. And that's when the kind of texture of the work is important.
It's a great to and fro between everybody. It's all very,
yeah,
very, very tight.
It's, yeah. No, it's, I'm glad you liked it. It's one of my favorite pieces of work ever, really. I think it's terrific.